Are we trying to wake up from the dream, or are we trying to modify the dream? That is a question all of us can ask ourselves, just to reset and reorient, just like that. Okay, what I'm doing, is this trying to modify the dream or trying to wake up from the dream? That is the question. The goal is to wake up from the dream. There's no need to modify a dream. Only need to wake up from it. Modification means we remain asleep. And the tendency is to get pulled down into trying to modify the dream. No, we only need to awaken. So our focus is on awakening from this dream, choosing a new idea, setting down belief, the belief in belief, which is what belief is, the belief in belief. And knowing that we've never not been enlightened. What we are, I am. The I am presence has always been the I am presence. It's never not been enlightened. It's never been sick. It's never been endangered. All these adventures that we're seeing in existence are not germane to what we are, our true identity, the I am-ness, the is-ness, which is the characteristic of reality, of all of reality. There's no process in reality. Everything, there's isness. There's the play of isness, and the expansion and play of isness. It's different than process. Process is the dream. This existence where everything is process. That is a dream. By dream, we mean it's our imagination. Obviously, when we fall asleep and are dreaming, we're somehow employing some type of imagination. Imagery. All of this is the imagery of the mind, existence, the imagery of the mind, the imagination of the mind. Mind is the servant of spirit. Spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. So mind is presenting a plausible scenario as to how that can happen. And what mind tells spirit is that, yes, it will happen for sure, 100% for sure, which is a lie. It's only a plausibility. And then tells spirit the way it's going to happen is that all of this dream is going to develop a power of negation over reality, a new power, and how this power will come to be will be some way of to catalyze it. There'll be some catalytic event which will make the hypothetical come true, and an imaginary power will become a real power, and then we'll be able to threaten the prime creator and say, prime creator, if you don't change reality and make us prime creator, we will destroy all of reality. So that is the scenario that we're in. And all of this existence is this imagination, the play of imagination that the mind is presenting. A hypothetical, plausible scenario of how we can make a new power that the prime creator didn't make, the power to destroy reality, that we can use then as leverage to force the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator. That's what we're involved in. And yet it's all a dream. It's all imagination. That's what it is. The isness of existence is that it's all imagination. That's what it is. It will always be just imagination. Imagination is imagination. Hypothetical is a hypothetical. It doesn't become transmuted into something else. That would deny its isness. What is never transmuted or changed into something else. Reality is not being transformed. Reality is not being changed. Never. It's not being altered. It's not being corrupted. It's not being made better or worse or anything. Reality, the isness of it, is constantly expanding. Okay, but it never loses the isness. Everything, all that is created, is what it is from the very beginning, and always is that. And it contains within it the expansion of all it is as well. So it's not a stagnant situation, a static stagnant, and yet there is no change in the isness of it at all. But in the dream, we see everything. There is no isness here. It seems like perception doesn't show us any isness at all. That's the land of no isness. And so we think maybe we need to fix the dream up a little bit. Put some window dressing on it. Where's the isness? You know, I can't find it. Let's work on it. No, that's not the way. The way is to simply wake up from the dream, to be in the presence of isness, and realize that isness was never sick. It never died. Nothing ever happened to it. All this dream is just imagining that this is all possible. It's imagining the perils of Pauline. It's imagining the perils of isness, that isness has been going through all these horrible vulnerabilities, and it's been suffering this and that, and all this fragmentation, etc., etc. Has not. So the waking up, as we try to wake up from the dream, what we find is we find all these defenses there that are trying to lure us away into not waking up. One of them came to mind today. There was someone there passing out. I was right ready to go to in the presence of business, and there's someone passing out a card or something and say, "Congratulations, you have won a free lifetime. This is your reward for getting this far. You get a free lifetime. Here's your pass to a free lifetime." And I said, "Well, what do you mean a free lifetime? What does that mean?" Because life in this universe and existence means unawareness of isness, denial of isness. How can that be free of the burden of this denial? How can it be free of the fear that this brings? How can it be free at all? It cannot. So what does it mean, free lifetime? It's like a reward points. And it's like a big, you know, balloons are falling, confetti, noisemakers, and everyone celebrating, say, "Wow, congratulations, you made it this far, and here is your reward," and they hand you a free pass for another lifetime. No thanks. It's very clever. And then all these fantasies and imaginings come up of like some kind of ideal type of existence, you know, where you have all this luxury, and you can write your own ticket to whatever kind of lifestyle you want in existence. That is offered too as a you know, reward for getting this far. But that is just the way that the dream tries to keep you from waking up. Waking up meaning that none of this was necessary. We're not doing this on the behalf of isness. Isness is not asking us to do this for some reason. We're trying to find some power that can destroy isness, is the fact of the whole situation. Okay. Isness doesn't need to be healed. It doesn't need to be propitiated. It doesn't need anything to be sacrificed to it. It doesn't need prayers. It doesn't need mantras. It doesn't need any modality of therapy. It doesn't need us to die. It doesn't need sickness. It doesn't need time. It doesn't need space. It doesn't need any of that. It's said that when Buddha went into meditation to attain nirvana, all these distractions arose. And I find this is very true. Nirvana means to be in the presence of the isness, the unconditional love, the unmoving, the unchanging, the isness, the oneness. When you get close to awakening from the dream and realizing that the isness has never been asleep, it's never been sick, it never died. It's just been waiting for this awakening to take place. It's just been imagining all this. When you get close to that, all these distractions are there trying to offer you something, you know, the better that's just, you know. And so those can trip us up, delay us. Those are delay tactics. We want to get past all the delay tactics, because troubles are coming up in the world, as we know. Back in 2011, around, what was it, July 5th or something, I said, "Hey, things are going to start unraveling. You'll start to see the process of a collapse that is coming. You'll start to see the first rumblings of that." Because I was shown in a dream, I was shown exactly what's going to happen. But the problem in a dream, meaning when I went to sleep, had a dream, not this greater dream of existence, a dream within a dream, time is compressed. It's like it's timeless. So you can't determine trying to determine how long events take. I knew when the things were going to get started, 2011. I said, for sure, it's going to get started. And I knew that in early November, October, I felt that there would be a possibility of the collapse then. But in the dream, everything happened boom, boom, boom. And there was nothing to tell me what the timeline was, is how much time in between there certain things are going to happen. I knew that there would be several mini collapses first. And the first mini collapse happened in November, late October, November, early November of 2011. The European banking system was basically broken, and they started printing money, which, of course, the Federal Reserve in the U.S. has been doing also for quite some time now. And they're doing more QE3, massive printing of money, which is an emergency measure. It's like someone in a coma, you know, putting them on some kind of medication to help deal with that, or like I know. When someone has some brain injury, sometimes they can artificially keep you in a coma, which somehow the healing is better because you're not moving, not, you know, doing anything. So there's all sorts of ways to prolong the patient, you know. So what I did was I said that it's possible that the collapse could come as early as October 2011 or sometime in early 2012. I said that it is possible, it's just conceivable. I didn't say for sure it is, but I say it is something that you need to consider as a possibility, you know, because it's better to leave early than to leave too late, right? For instance, if there's an iron curtain going down, it's better you leave a bit ahead of time than too late, because when it's too late, you can't get out. So you always want to plan for something very serious. You want to give yourself plenty of time and get set up ahead of time, not when it's too late. So warnings that are too late are no good whatsoever. So I took the worst case scenario that it might happen, you know, in late 2011, early 2012 as a possibility, and it didn't. Which is a great thing, very great thing. And yet here we've had a whole year of tremendous accelerated progress, realizing, you know, it's coming very soon. And the difficulty for anybody to figure out exact dates is because in dreams, dreams are like timeless, very much so. I remember one time waking up from a dream. It was the most extraordinary thing. I was having a dream of time itself. And within that dream, I felt that I was dreaming for, you know, hundreds of years, and all this stuff was happening, and yet I was aware, it was a semi-sleep state, I was aware that I did all of this in just an instant, like a second or something, where we're able to dream in 1 second, an instant, we're able to dream of time, and all this multitudinous things are happening in time, as if we're dreaming for 100 years, and I was aware it all took place in 1 instant. Incredible. The power of our mind's imagining is absolutely amazing. Jesus said in A Course in Miracles, he said that we literally imagine all of the universe existence in 1 instant. Everything that's happened or ever will happen, we did it all in an instant, which is, you know, incredible. But I saw that that is definitely possible. So it is super difficult when you're having dreams to assess time. You know, it can be so compressed. You can have many events taking place in very quick. Also in a dream, you can do many events quickly. So you think, oh, what happened? Bam, bam, bam. And yet it may be stretched out for a couple, you know, a decade or more, something like that. So it is tough, but it's better to give the most dire possibility first and then say, okay, and hope that it doesn't happen. So it's a very good thing that it hasn't happened yet. Extraordinary steps have been taken to postpone it a little bit. The narrative that is being advanced in various places, and it seems to be heading in that direction, is that the collapse will take place sometime in between this next election, 2013 and 2016, when the next election takes place in the U.S. presidential election, likely to take place in that time frame. And what might happen is that whoever is elected president, I feel the present president number 44, POTUS number 44, is going to win this upcoming election, and then the, when the collapse will come, and then this president will ask for special, be given special powers and the constitutional provision that you can only have two terms as president, ask that be waived, and that the second term will be extended. Okay, extended. There won't be another election in 2016. That the Congress will give the authority for this president to continue on as president to fix the collapse. They'll feel that the things are so chaotic, it's impossible to have an election. Really, things will be that bad. And then martial law will be passed, and then you'll have a dictatorship in the United States. That's very, very possible. And it will be really bad, really, really, really bad. Now, the importance of these videos is to, again, awaken from the dream. And that will be the ultimate protection, because you realize you don't need anything to happen in a dream in order to awake from it. In other words, your awakening is not dependent on what's happening in the dream. And the fact of your isness is not dependent on what happens in a dream at all. Makes no difference whatsoever. Okay. It is the remedy for everything that can possibly be happening in the dream. It is the remedy for it. To be in the presence of isness and to accept it and allow it and realize that it is this isness that is reality, and the dream has no bearing on this isness whatsoever. Awakening from the dream. It can be done. And it needs to be done because of the events that are going to take place. The unsecured, the debt, if the numbers don't add up, you know, a collapse is inevitable. Fiat money is going to collapse. The currency of various countries is going to collapse. And there's going to be a one world currency, one world banking system, all that stuff. And it's likely that the POTUS, President of the United States, will be the head of that new world order, having been given the authority to continue their term in office past the next 2016 election. Because, again, situations will be so drastic, so chaotic, so terrible, there's no way you could really even hold an election. Okay? So, it's a great thing the collapse hasn't happened yet. But yet we have to continue this relentless effort to awaken from the dream, to choose a new idea. And it is very, very doable. I'm simply seeing these desperate defenses just prior to being in accepting the presence of isness. Now, these can lead to side trips, of course. I'm looking, see, oh yeah, that's a side trip. Been there, done that. There's another side trip. Been there, done that. All designed to just prevent this awakening from taking place. Dropping the dream, saying, what I am, which is the isness that I am, never died, never was sick, never was in need of any learning, never needed to go through anything that the dream gave rise to. And it's just simply always been what it is. And just accepting that. Seeing it, experiencing it, accepting it. That is the ultimate remedy for all of existence, including the things that will take place soon in this world. And it's a blessing that we still have some time here. But who knows, you know, exactly, again, knowing the exact time frame, everything is very, very difficult. But it does seem apparent that this election of 2012 will take place. It does, at this point, it seems that way. And once this one takes place, and again, I believe the president, POTUS 44, will be reelected, very likely be reelected, then the collapse scenario is going to accelerate, and at some point the wheels will certainly come off. already the agitation of the, we're feeling it. We're already starting to, you know, we see the iceberg out there. There's some people are on the deck of the Titanic looking out there. What is that out there? It looks like, you know, something. It's kind of dark. We've got the binoculars on. We're looking. And we say, it looks like there's something out there. It really seems that way, you know. And we've got some reports of lots of icebergs in the area, and somebody reporting that there seems to be one that might be in our, you know, right in our direction that we're going in. And so we're nervous. We're getting nervous about it. I've been nervous about it for a long time because I had this very clear vision that was shown to me exactly what's going to happen. And I realized, wow, this is going to happen. So, but now a lot of people are feeling it because it's getting so close, you know, that it's impinging upon us. There's red flags being tossed every day. Red flags are being tossed all over the place. And we're saying, uh-oh, you know, this is worse than we thought. So what I've said in every video is that the spiritual path to the I am isness is essential during these times, absolutely essential. It's way better than trying to be, you know, survivor, going into, you know, survivor status, and all that kind of stuff, which, it, you know, isn't wrong to do. But awakening from this dream changes everything, not in the world, but it changes your positioning in the world entirely. The willingness to be in the I am isness, to accept it in some way, to accept it not as a person having a relationship with it so much, but as an awakening, realizing, hey, I've been dreaming all this. I don't need to dream any of it. I don't need to keep the dream going, because the I am is being healed in the dream. Don't need to do it. You know, we have all this supposed evolution taking place, and within that we think that we're going to come up with some cure for something. And so that's in a dream. And so as you start awakening from the dream, we say, well, wait a minute. I see everything's getting kind of fuzzy and faint, and I'm starting to lose the parts of the dream that are supposedly going to heal everything. I don't want to lose those, you know. So you go back into the dream. Where the truth is, you don't need any of the dream. The I am reality, identity, is completely unharmed. It's never been sick. It doesn't need any therapeutic measures taken whatsoever. None. So why do we need to keep a dream full of therapeutic measures going? Whatever those may be, you know. Everybody being one in the dream. Why do we, everything, reality already is one. Why do we need a dream of everybody trying to become one? Why do we need any of that? Reality is already completely self-aware, the isness. We don't need some meditation and contemplation for reality, for isness to be what it is. We don't need some enlightened human beings. Reality's already enlightened. It's never not been enlightened. It's only in the dream that all this nonsense arises as plausibility. We don't need any of that. So as we're awakening, we awaken from the entirety of the dream. The good, the bad, and the ugly. We don't need any of it. And then our relationship to the universe is one that we see, it's clearly is simply a dream. That's all it is. Time and space is a dream. Everything that's happening is simply a dream. And we realize it has absolutely nothing to do with what we are, nothing to do with reality whatsoever. It's just a silly, a ridiculous, whimsical, foolish dream. And then at that point, our capability, we begin to be remember, you know, that we can choose our experiencing in reality. It's a whole different ballgame. But our focus is right on awakening from the dream. That's where it has to be. We don't worry about anything beyond that. It's not important. In our focus has to be that we can do it. The last video was yes, we can awaken from the dream. And this has to be reinforced. Yes, we can. And that'll push the fear aside, the growing fear. There are so many dictatorial strands that are wrapping themselves around the body politic now. So many. You can feel the icy tentacles gripping you. And it's very, very disturbing. And yet, if you are focused on your, yes, I can awaken from this dream, and that is your intent, then you're going to be able to get free of this stuff. It'll become inconsequential to you. You won't struggle with it. You realize, that too, I'll awaken from that too. Whatever arises, you say, that too will vanish in like the mist when I realize that this dream doesn't need to be dreamed. I've given up the purpose. I've chosen a different idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and I don't need this dream to help out reality. Reality doesn't need to be helped out. I don't need this dream to heal what I am. What I am doesn't need to be healed. Has never needed it and will never need it. It's not like I need to develop some kind of pill in case reality ever comes down with a bad case of the flu. You know, no. Reality will never come down with a bad case of the flu. It will never be sick. So we don't have to keep on researching. The research we do in this world is really very clever. We're just trying to locate all the weak points and areas of vulnerability, new areas of vulnerability, supposedly to try and protect against sickness in those areas, and et cetera, et cetera. It's all a dream. It's all our imagination. It has no basis, foundation, reality whatsoever. So in this video, we have touched upon a scenario, likely scenario, that definitely the collapse is coming. It's just hard to pinpoint when. And at this point, I said again, I thought it might, the earliest it could happen would be in early November, late October, early November of 2011. That's the earliest I said it could possibly happen. It almost did, but the patient was put on life support, as it were. So as far as exactly when it'll happen right now, I haven't gotten any additional clarification on that, except it is that the signs are certainly ominous that the whole scenario is being mainlined, really mainlined. And it makes one nervous. If one is really aware of freedom of speech, civil rights, all this freedom that we're brought up on, if you're brought up on that, as I was, on that great tradition, and encouraged to exercise this freedom, because if we don't exercise it, it's lost. It gets lost easily. You can feel the erosion is like a massive storm hitting the land, and it's just eroding it incredibly fast. And there's generations of people in the U.S. who have not been brought up on the full freedoms of this country, where there's been many restrictions placed down, especially in speech. You could be charged all sorts of crimes by what you say now, and so they don't even know that how much freedom has been lost here. They're not even aware of it. It's amazing. It's the older people that are aware of it, which is why they're the ones who are most alarmed. And if they point out that, hey, there's all this stuff happening, people say, oh, you're crazy, what are you talking about? Just getting old. But it's the older people who lived in the country where there was this tremendous celebration and cherishing of the freedoms and the Bill of Rights and all of that, who realize now it's under unbelievable assault, and it's being termited and undermined to an extraordinary extent, and that the amount of freedoms that have been compromised or lost is enormous. And it's exponential, the loss is exponential, and that there really is very little in the way of this whole thing ending up into a dictatorship, martial law, etc., all of that. The way is paved already for that, and the will is not there to stop it, because there's too many young people who have not did not grow up in this climate of freedom. So they're not even aware of it. So for them, they say, hey, what's the matter? What's the big deal? It doesn't seem, things seems pretty normal to us. You see, that's the problem. And they can say, yeah, I see a little bit of problem, but this is what I'm used to. This is what I grew up in. It's not that big of a deal. And they don't realize that it is an enormous change in a very short period of time over the last 50 some odd years. And so when there's enough of those people, young people who have grown up in a situation where freedom has been already been undermined to a great extent, they think, oh, this is pretty normal, no big deal. And enough of those are a voting age, you know, or you get enough people who are not used to this freedom, not aware of it, and they say, oh, it's no big deal. Some people even think, well, dictatorship, oh, that shouldn't be any big deal, you know. But for those who grew up in the freedom, they realize it is a big deal. Because the freedom is the freedom to challenge the dream itself and awaken from the dream. It's a feeling that, yes, we can use our freedom in this way if we so choose. Not everybody does it. You know, most don't. But we can, if we want to, use free speech, freedom of expression, freedom of challenging authority. Okay, super important to have this feeling you can challenge authority. Freedom to challenge perceptions, beliefs of all types. Freedom to say, hey, I don't necessarily have to subscribe to this belief or that belief or any belief. Those types of freedoms. Freedom all of that is being swept away. And you won't have that. You will be assigned roles. You will be assigned beliefs. You will be thoroughly vetted and tested. And you will be go through a re-education process and reassignment process. And what happened is there will be a collective belief system will arise, which is already arising, actually. And it's not just a peer pressure at home or at school or among your peers. It is a collective societal peer pressure system that is getting everybody to agree on certain norms, new norms. Okay. One of the most important norms is to believe in belief. Okay, and the idea is that everybody can agree upon that. What is being done is saying, let's find some norms that we can all agree upon globally. Okay, and the most important one would be we believe in belief. Whereas the whole idea of awakening from this dream is to no longer believe in belief, to challenge belief itself. Not any particular belief, but belief itself. However, in the challenging of belief itself, it's very important to feel free to challenge all beliefs, any particular belief. You should feel that you have the right, without any retribution being directed towards you, from society, from government, to challenge that belief. Whatever it is. Whatever. No such thing as all this hate stuff, all these, you know, laws of saying, well, this is hate. You can't challenge this belief. You cannot challenge that belief. Now, that is not freedom at all. The freedom is to challenge any belief and to look at it and say, is this belief really true? Or is it just a belief? And you'll find out all beliefs are just beliefs. There's no real truth to them at all. There is a belief in beliefs. But as you're able to exercise your freedom, you're able to get to the point where you're able to challenge belief itself and realize that belief is just belief in a dream. It's belief in belief, and belief is just a dream. It's just imagination. It's not isness. It's imagination. And that enables you then to awaken from the dream. Whereas when you're in a situation where that is not allowed, what's going to happen is you're going to be put through a re-education process. The dictatorship will say, listen, we have to recover from this collapse, and we need everybody to be doing the right role. Like in wartime, like World War II, everybody was assigned roles in society, okay? and everybody carrying out the roles that they were most suited to. I mean, they gave aptitude tests and vocational tests and all this stuff, and they said, okay, you need to do this, and you need to go over here, and everybody was assigned roles and told what they can say, how they can act, and everyone went with the program, right, because we needed to win the war. Well, in this upcoming global economic financial collapse, will be, you know, exponentially, immeasurably worse than a world war. And the very survival will be at stake. And what will happen is this dictatorship, a new world order, will... I just lost the video on this. Okay, will assign roles to everybody. And how that will happen is you'll go through this re-education process, which is a process to determine your attitudes and aptitudes and your whole psychology and everything, you know, and to see, you know, what you need to be optimized for your role, what kind of drugs, what kind of medications, what kind of psychiatric treatment, what kind of re-education type treatment you need. And these things have already been tested out, like in Russia and China and various places previously, of how do you re-educate a population? And how do you get rid of the malcontents and those people who seem unfit to fulfill a productive role that's an assigned role to them? In other words, the free thinkers will be then sent to some gulag, which was happened. That's what happens. This is going to happen on a grand scale. And what I saw is that I had a dream last night, and I saw this freeway. You know, I was on two lanes, a slow lane and a fast lane, going in one direction of a freeway. And I was going on the fast lane, and there was nobody in the fast lane. Nobody. And I was going really, really fast in the fast lane. And then I looked over in the slow lane, and the slow lane was completely jammed with bumper-to-bumper traffic. And in fact, it was so jammed, it was hardly moving at all. Everybody was in the slow lane. Everybody. And here I was zipping along the fast lane. There's nobody in the fast lane. And I thought, wow, maybe it's closed up ahead or construction. And, you know, and there's some... But I looked and I kept driving. No, there's no construction, you know. It wasn't closed. What has happened was that everybody had been told they need to get in the slow lane because they need to go through this checkpoint type of thing where they are assigned roles of, you know, to help the whole culture, society survive. And so here I am going the fast lane. I'm thinking, uh-oh, you know, wow. I'm really sticking out here because I'm sure everyone's looking at me driving by at 70 miles an hour, where they're like going like at 2 miles an hour, and thinking, you know, who in the heck does he think he is? Who is that? You know, didn't he get the memo? Well, he must be crazy. He didn't get the memo, and he's not a team player. He's trying to be separate. You know, he's selfish. All, you know, this whole guilt trip. Why aren't you over in the slow lane? Because the slow lane is, again, to vet everybody, then to assign them roles. Okay, they've got all these ways of doing it, very sophisticated ways now. They're developing high technology ways of scanning your thought forms and all of that stuff. So they'll be able to tell, you know, what are you best able to do? And then you'll get assigned those roles. It'll be a dictatorship. It's not a dictatorship. The upcoming dictatorship is a high-tech dictatorship, which will use data. Why do you think they're collecting all the data on the internet right now? Because they're already creating profiles of everybody they can, so that they can, in advance, already know, okay, you need to be assigned to this. You know, you're you know, upper management here, your management here, you're working here, you're doing this. This is what you're, you know, best suited for. And these are the things that we need to suppress in you. And they'll have mind suppression techniques, high-tech techniques to do all that kind of stuff. Make the Chinese look like amateurs, you know, in all their brainwashing, the techniques that they use, the North Koreans, the Soviets, and other dictatorships, repressive regimes. Repressive regimes meaning that they go through the whole population and call the entire population and determine where each person should be working, what their hours are, what their wages are, everything determined. No free enterprise, no freedom whatsoever. You are, you know, you are given, assigned a role, and you are worker number such and such, and this is your hours, you know, with a graveyard shift or swing shift or whatever. This is where you go, and this is how much time you have off. Everything is managed. Central management. Central management is what we're looking at coming up here. Now, for a free thinker, such as myself or anyone like that, it's impossible. It cannot function under those circumstances. It's like a living death. Worse, you know. And so, here I am zipping along in the fast lane and saying, whoa, you know, this is kind of nerve-wracking because everyone else is in the slow lane. And here I am, you know, I'm sort of, you know, separate from the crowd. The crowd. But the crowd is just a cattle call. Again, they're being told collectively, this is the process we must go through. Now, so if we wait before waking up from the dream until the point where this vetting process is actually taking place, where this role assignation is taking place, where central bureaucracy is determining what everybody must do in order to rebuild civilization, if we wait until then, the peer pressure will be too great. Plus, all the laws will make it, you know, criminal not to be assigned, you know, and that's where the barcode comes in, where everybody will have some kind of, tattooed identification or barcode identification, RFRIF, or some, you know, some chipping. There'll be a microchipping in everyone that will track, make sure that they are doing the roles that they were assigned to do. And they'll include a GPS, it'll have a satellite, everything. They'll be able to know exactly where you are, where you went, everything. All your phone calls, all your email, all your movements, everything will be electronically, wirelessly collected. And there'll be all these algorithms that, you know, if you do anything that's outside of the parameters of what you're supposed to be doing, that will be red flagged. And you will be, if you get enough of those red flags, you will be brought in to, for some re-education, you see. But so at that point, you know, the laws of the land will be so severe, people will be trapped. Really, really trapped. And this is coming very soon because the technology is already here. They're putting the final touches on it, and they're frantically working on this. All of this technology that's coming in is for that purpose. It's for that purpose. We don't, you know, some people are realizing this, waking up to it. They're saying, hey, you know, they're tracking. They've been tracking me, keeping track of everything I do. and for me, of course, they're going to say, oh, this guy, you know, cannot be reeducated. We can't. There's no role we can give this guy. So put him in the dump. So, of course, I say, hey, I got to wake up from the dream, obviously. And that's all important. And then, of course, I understand people don't want to comment on the videos. They can put, you know, hit the like button. You know, if you don't want to comment, hit the like button. Because if you comment, you think, uh-oh, I've left a paper, you know, electronic trail of, you know, maybe, you know, being into this awakening from the dream. And that could be, that'll appear on my record, data record, you know. Profile, my data resume, and they'll say, huh, you know, wow, this guy or this person looks like a troublemaker. We don't want any troublemakers. We want everyone to go get along with the program, follow dear leader. And so I noticed that. That's okay. If you don't want to comment, that's all right, because it seems like a death sentence or something. But you can always hit the like button. Let me know, you know, if you're really watching and you like what's being said and you realize, yeah, this is true, hit the like button. And that helps me continue on. I've got close to 150 subscribers and, you know, close to 100, you know, sometimes videos get 100 views, which is good. If I get 100 views, 150 subscribers, that's enough reason to continue on. And my plan is to awaken from the dream and then allow people to get a sense how that is and be helpful in that way. And then they can consider, you know, if you're really, you'll know in your own heart if you think that going through this dictatorship is what you want, or if you decide no. No way can I survive that, because my spirit craves true freedom and truth and freedom of expression, freedom of thought, and freedom to challenge authority, freedom, all that freedom, if that's what that's, if you're wired that way, and you realize, oh, there's no way I can go through this dictatorship like this, and then you say, wow, I really better get with it. I really better get with it. And I keep telling myself, I need to awaken from this dream to just to help others, you know, because I'm aware of the situation. And I really need to get with that. I really need to get awakened from this. It's a severe situation. And then be available in some way, in some very various ways, so those who realize they need to awaken too can get a boost in that. Because it is coming soon, and it is going to be very drastic. Very drastic. They have all sorts of electronic ways now, high-tech ways to interfere with your thinking, your brain, alter your brain chemistry, all this kind of stuff, turn you into a compliant drone, all sorts of ways. They've been getting help in this from various sources. Various ET civilizations, actually. There have been exchange of all sorts of high technology stuff take place, and a lot of development in mind control, basically, and how to control a population, how to have a population of drones, essentially, and how to, they're trying to figure a way to transition out of, from freedom into this drone state. And there are already, you know, many, many drones, you know, maybe even the majority of the population of the United States already is in the drone condition already, most likely, which is why the present POTUS is going to be reelected, is because that's, you know, that's part of the drone program. Part of the program of a coming dictatorship. And you know, they say, hey, you know, now if you believe in belief, you believe in the dream, you're gonna say, hey, you know, rebuilding civilization is a great thing. No, you know, I'm not gonna say no, you know, that's wrong. Of course, based on the premise of the dream, it will seem like the right thing to do. But if you realize that the dream is only just a dream, it's all make-believe, it's a dream of trying to create a power of death or destruction. And this dream is nothing but a merciless massacre. Okay, if you realize that and see it, you say, no, I don't want to continue off the dream. I don't want to rebuild civilization. I want to awaken from the dream. It's a nightmare. When you're having a nightmare, you're at sleep, you know, when you wake up, you know, it's like you go, oh, that's great. I remember sometimes my wife's having nightmares, you know, and crying or screaming in her sleep, and I say, boom, boom, I try to wake her up. Sometimes it's really difficult. And I'll finally, I'll wake her up, and she'll go, oh, you know, and then say, oh, thank you for waking me up, because otherwise I would have kept on with this horrible nightmare. I thought I was going to die. And so people are grateful to be woken up from nightmares. You know, they need to be shaken and say, hey, wake up. And they wake up and say, oh, wow, that was a horrible nightmare I was having. And thank you so much for doing that. So for those who realize that this dream really is a nightmare, and all the so-called good stuff is just window dressing to keep suckering us into continuing on with it. You know, you don't want to become a drone. That's the last thing you could ever want, to be a drone in the dream. Who wants to be a drone in the dream? So, but it's necessary then to awaken. Otherwise, you will be a drone in the dream. Or you'll be turned into fertilizer. So it is necessary, and it is doable. It is doable. And there have been those who have done it throughout history. Yes, they have. It has happened. It has been done. It's simply a matter of being able to look at the situation without getting off track, staying quiet, staying still, and letting the evaluation take place. Letting the reluctance erode. Being able to look at the distractions and see them as distractions. See them as attempt to modify the dream instead of to awaken from the dream. One of mine is, I'm going down the hallway, you know, and at the end of the hall, there's the I Am presence is there. And yet, in through a doorway, I hear this music, you know, and I say, what is that music? I'm listen to it a little bit, and I say, you know what, I could make that music even better. You know, it's nice music. I could do better. Then someone says, hey, look who's here, you know. Look who's here. The musician is here. Come on in the room. You know, can you help us out? You know, this. And I say, well, yeah, you know, I probably could, you know. And I say, whoa, wait a minute. I want to go to that I Am presence. I almost forgot. All these jingles, you know. I was listening to radio jingles a couple nights ago. On YouTube, PAMS, P-A-M-S, it was the original radio jingle producer down in Dallas, Texas, Joseph Meeks. I used to have a little green box from Joseph Meeks that was supposed to, if you tweak it right, it was supposed to create like some kind of incredible sound in my recording studio. And it didn't. it was like everyone was saying, yeah, this will give like that old tube, you know, give that resonance and tube sound and all this great stuff. And just dial in all these knobs, all this recording equipment has all these knobs. And you feel like for sure, if you just dial everything in just right, you know, that over here, that over there, down here, then slide all these levers and everything, somehow whatever's going to come out is going to be super great. It's not. It's more to it than that. Anyway, this Joe Meeks created this incredible industry of jingles for radio stations. They had jingles for commercial products before, but this is jingles for radio stations and television stations. And boy, listening to those, you can listen to them on YouTube. It's incredible. Incredible. The creativity of those people was amazing. Amazing. It still sounds amazing. And yet I think like, hey, you know, I can do all sorts of jingles. I can come up with stuff that's even better, you know, and which is true. Theoretically, plausibly. And so as you advance towards the I Am presence, you're going to hear all through the walls, you're gonna hear all this interesting stuff going on. And you kind of put your ear to the wall, you know, and say, hey, what's going on in there? And over here, here's something that sounds like fun what they're doing in there. It's like, I could do that too. I could get with that. And then you gotta say, whoa, no, wait a minute. My goal is to awaken from the dream, not to try and modify the dream, because all those jingles and all the music, etc. I can, you know, what problem is, once I start listening to music, I can actually start, what happens is my mind starts composing music and tunes, you know, and I say, hey, wait a minute. That's an original tune. I've never heard anything like that before. And it'd be a great song. Great song. That's kind of like the curse. Is I can come up with great songs, just boom, boom, boom. And I have to say, no. Really. I can literally give birth to endless amounts of music. Right out of my mind, just pouring out. And I have to say, no. No. Stop. Time out. You know. Time out. Take a time out. Let's not do that. As I said, most of my music I threw away. I don't even have it anymore. I have a few songs that I made, but a lot of stuff that was super creative, threw it away in the past. And now I say, no, that, wow. If you want a diversion that'll keep you away from awakening from the dream, music will really do it. Because the better you get at it, more the creativity, you realize you can just churn out whatever, pop song, a symphony, jingles, rap, you name it, anything, you can just pour it out if you want to. And, you know, it's like, I say, oh my gosh, if I really was able to record this and had all the right, you know, arrangement and the right singers, all the right equipment, everything, you know, just take you into, you know, Columbia Studios or, you know, whatever studios there are, and have all the right engineers and producers and, you know, start laying down this music, you know, these songs would be hits. They would be hit songs. Supposedly, if they have the right distribution and people say, yeah, I want this to be a hit song, which is generally the way the music industry works. It's very, very manipulative. You could do it. And you can, you know, could do it and do it and do it and do it and do it. But you would be working on modifying the dream. You wouldn't be working on awakening from the dream. And at the end of your life, you say, oops, fooled again. You know that song, we won't get fooled again. Well, we always get fooled again in existence. Who was the who fooling when they sang, we won't get fooled again? Who were they fooling? You know, they're trying, the whole idea, you know, it's an expression, of course, of young Aang saying, hey, we don't want to get fooled again, but of course we get fooled again. Just the fact that we are churning out this great music is getting fooled again. If you want to awaken from the dream, you're not churning out great music. You're not even listening to great music. Been there, done that. You know, and I got fooled again because I was determined to awaken from the dream, and I heard this great music. And I said, you know, I'm going to listen to this. This is interesting. And I said, you know what? Maybe I could use this, you know, to make even better music. I said, that's a possibility. So I ended up getting sucked into music again, whereas I was determined not to because I knew it was a side trip. What happened was I listened to the Beach Boys. I heard a song, I Get Around, and I listened to it. I said, wow, that's genius. That's incredible. How do they pull that off? And I started listening to more of the Beach Boys. And before you know it, I started to listen to all this music again. All this music. And I got pulled into music again, whereas I didn't want to get pulled into music at all because I knew it was a side trip. So for me, that was how I fell from grace, was music caused that. In other words, I was almost to the I Am Presence. I heard some tunes through the wall. I heard, you know, I Get Around. I said, round, round, get around, I get around. What is that? What is that? Let me listen to that. Let me just listen to this one thing. Just one. I just want to hear that. Okay, now who composed that? How did they do that? Let me figure this out. And from that, I went into the room, and when I was in the room, I heard all this other music, and before too long, I was completely enmeshed in music again. And I said, oh gosh, something's wrong, you know, and I said, I can do it all. I can still awaken from the dream and yet still be involved in this all this music. And I said, you know what, I'll compose music for awakening from the dream, which is what I tried to do. I said, yeah, no, I'm not being sidetracked. I'll just compose a soundtrack for awakening from the dream, which is what I worked on. But it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. That's not how you awaken from the dream. You don't awaken from the dream through music. You do not. I guarantee you that. And if you are transitioning to listening to less and less music, that's a very great thing. That's a sure sign that you are focusing more on awakening from the dream instead of being trying to modify the dream. You know, the temptation was, I thought, you know what, I could probably write a song that is so perfect that it's going to help everyone awaken from the dream. That is the intent, right? But that's nonsense. That's not how you awaken from the dream. Not at all. You can spend your entire life listening to music. I mean, I spent much of my life listening to music nonstop, constantly finding better and better and better and better music. You know, it was just like the best of the best and being immersed in it. And no, that doesn't work at all. At the same time, I was also working on awakening. But what I've found out and seen now is that the music was a side trip. It's really an attempt to modify the dream. But the muse doesn't tell you that. There really is a muse, okay? Very much of a liar and a deceiver, telling you that your involvement in the music will help everyone else awaken, that you can compose a soundtrack to awakening from the dream. It's not true. That's a horrendous lie. It's caused me enormous delay. And in that delay, tremendous suffering. Don't get involved in music, or if you are, get out of it. Make a transition out of it, which I have been able to do. Very difficult. Had to get rid of all my musical instruments, which I had, you know, so many that I can't even count them. Had to get rid of all my equipment, everything. I was able to get rid of everything. I think I have a ukulele still, which I don't play. That's it. But I had just everything, almost, you name it, almost, I had it. And I had to get rid of all of it. I had to stop composing music, stop recording it, and even stop listening to it. Even now, if I start listening to it, it's amazing how fast I get pulled away. And I start composing in my mind, and before you know it, I say, wow, that's a great tune. You know, I wonder if I should, you know, put some chords to that, and maybe you can give it to somebody, you know, and just, you know, you start thinking before you, and not even focusing on awakening anymore, because you think, I can't let this string of creativity go, because it'll be lost forever, and you know, I need to give this to the world, that kind of stuff. No, what we need to give to the world is awakening from the dream. Only that helps. Okay, not music. Doesn't help. But if you're a musician, of course, you're in a situation where you have to make a transition. It's not easy. Any kind of artist, anything, this applies to anything, whatever job you're in, whatever you're doing, you think you're helping the world. You're really trying to modify the dream. And when you try to modify the dream, you're actually reinforcing delusion. You're going deeper into sleep. Okay. Jesus said you can't have faith in two different directions. You can't have equal faith in two different directions. You put faith in two different directions, it's no faith at all, is it? They cancel each other out. The faith cancels itself out. So if you're trying to modify the dream, that inherently reinforces the notion that something must have happened to the I Am presence. Must have. Or else why would you be trying to modify the dream at all? Right? If nothing has happened, you don't need anything, any outcome in the dream whatsoever. It's completely irrelevant. All outcomes are totally irrelevant. Totally. If this dream has not affected I Am presence or never will at all, then all outcomes are equally unimportant, inconsequential. And you don't need to work on reaching any outcome at all in the dream at all. You need simply to awaken from the dream. So even trying to reach some great outcome in the dream, like I'm going to write the soundtrack, the backing track to the whole awakening from the dream, that's still trying to bring about an effect in the dream, which reinforces the belief. It actually prevents you from awakening from the dream. It scares you from it. But if you're busy working on something creative to modify the dream, you won't realize that you're being trapped. You won't realize that you're actually creating more fear for yourself. You won't realize it because you think, no, I'm being really creative. Now I'm making a great movie, and I've got a great soundtrack, and I'm composing all this stuff, and this is just going to help the world so much. It's actually generating more fear for yourself and the world. That is true. The ones who help the most are the ones who are very quiet and not doing any, really trying to modify the dream in any way, and who are working on awakening from the dream, and then the ones who have awakened from the dream, who are abiding in the I Am presence, the isness, they're being super helpful to the world, super helpful. So awakening is not about music. It's not about singing. Good grief. Been there and done that. And it's possible to modify music in endless ways. It's possible to modify the whole dream in endless ways. Some of them, a lot of them seem very, very interesting and creative and showy and clever. Lots of tinsel. We can come up with lots of tinsel on the dream. I may have to take a quite quick break here. But that just entrenches our fear even greater. Just 1 second. All of that reinforces the premise of the dream, okay, which is that the hypothetical, our imagination, we can change reality, we can alter reality, or we can threaten reality. It reinforces all of that, which is a huge problem. So here you are spending your life in some creative endeavor doing, you know, churning out all this stuff that's supposed to help the world. And then you say, okay, I've done all that. And you say, okay, where's that I am presence? And you can't find it. You can't see it. And you say, oh, it's down there. And suddenly a wave of fear will hit you. And you go, oh, no. I got to go back to my, you know, my studio and write another song. If composing music is supposedly so that great, show me the musicians who have awakened from the dream. Show me them. You can't find any of them. You might have won. If being creative is supposed to bring about awakening from the dream, show me anyone who's awakened from the dream who, you know, is some super creative, you know, been involved in all this creativity and still saying, yeah, that's what you're supposed to do. Show me one. If you can't find any, then it should get you to thinking, right? Saying, wow, wait a minute. No, always the creative people, they take a peek, and then they say, uh-oh. And they go jump back in their studio. Another painting, you know. I need to make it more abstract. I need to do a better painting. Apparently, I haven't quite succeeded. They haven't succeeded because they have not been examining, focusing, and looking where you need to look. Their attention has not been on where it needs to be. The attention has to be on the root of the situation. If you want to awaken, you have to place yourself right there, the I am presence, say, what is the fear? What is going on here? And look at the confusion that arises. And you have to push aside all the distractions that say, go modify, you know, the dream. There's all these muses in whatever guise that seems to be most attractive to you. And the muses will say, oh, come follow us. We will show you how to modify the dream in such beautiful ways. You know, they're all there telling you that they can inspire you. And there's also the joker in the deck would say, hey, you get it. Here's a free pass to existence. Say, no. Say no to all of those. Just look right at the situation without trying to be creative about it in any way. What need is reality? Does it need the creativity of imagination? What need does it have for that? Is it lacking something? Is reality lacking in some way? Is reality incapable of generating its own experience? Does it really need the help of imagination? Does it need the help of imagery? Does it really need the help of music? Does it need all this stuff that us humans do with opposable thumbs, you know, are able to churn out? Does it really need all that stuff to be what it is? Does isness need all of that to be what it is? Does isness need it for isness? What does isness need for isness? Nothing. It's created as isness. It remains always as isness. It doesn't need a song to be isness. And yet that's what we believe, that it's lacking in isness. Somehow reality is lacking in something. Somehow there's a power that is capable of destroying isness. And of course we're pretending that we're just trying to help isness, you know, but that's a cover. Duality is a cover. Really the purpose of existence is to come up with a means to destroy reality, destroy isness, and threaten the prime creator with that, force the prime creator, change reality and make us prime creator. But we cover that up by saying, claiming, no, we're trying to heal isness. We're working on therapies and positive things and, you know, butterflies and puppies and all this kind of stuff. And that we're trying to find a way to somehow make isness whole. We want to make it holy. Make it whole. You know the drill, right? All this positive stuff, right? We need, you know, we need to make it one. We need the oneness to somehow, we need to figure out this. No, it's always been one. Doesn't need to become one. Never lost the oneness. The whole premise that we need to make it one is that the premise is resting on the premise that it somehow lost the oneness. That, in other words, reality is vulnerable to threat, to be destroyed. That's a false premise. So all the stuff, you know, we want to heal it. That's the premise is that it was harmed in some way, right? Of course. So the chicken, the egg thing about existence is easily answered. What came first? The desire to develop a means, a power to destroy reality came first. What came second? desire to hide this, to gloss it over and pretend that no, the real purpose is we're trying to all become one. You know, got all these people, all these bodies everywhere, and we're all trying to be, these bodies are all trying to become one, all trying to become loving, all trying to heal, all trying to heal all the hurt and the pain and the trauma and all that kind of stuff. That's a secondary disguise for existence. It's a cover for what's really taking place. So there's no confusion about chicken and egg thing at all. None. Reality doesn't need our help. Doesn't need the help of a dream. Reality doesn't need the help of a dream. So this kind of focus is what enables awakening from the dream to take place, to draw close to that. Right? And it's pushing aside all these muses. Before the I am is the isness, the presence of isness, which is just sitting there, you know, completely in the as it is, with all creativity and delight, and it's just sitting there waiting for us to let go of this dream, to recognition, let go of this dream. Waiting for it to let go of the dream, really, ultimately, is what takes place. But we see it as if we're letting go of it. There's this congregation of, you know, muses there to supposedly inspire you. Say, oh, you're almost there. Congratulations. But now you just need to go do something really great. Go save the world. You know, you should be so inspired. You're so close to it. You should use that inspiration to do something truly inspirational in the world, meaning in the dream. No. You must say no to all of that. That's what Buddha's testimony, right? A Buddha going through all this inner focus of you. You reach all these, go through all these distractions, and even some ones that seem so lovely and heavenly, and they're here to help you, inspire you to save the world. No, no, no. Say no, no, no. I don't need to save the world. I don't need to save the dream. I need to awaken from the dream. Nothing needs to be saved within the dream. The dream doesn't need to be saved. It doesn't need to be preserved. It doesn't need to be changed in any way or modified in any way, good, bad, or ugly. You don't need to make it better. You don't need to make it worse. You don't need to make it pretty. You don't need to make it ugly. You don't need to preserve any part of it. You don't need to destroy any part of it. You don't need to do anything. You don't need to do anything. At all, except that realization is, hey, since I don't need to do anything at all, I don't really need this dream anymore. And that's called awakening from the dream. You realize it serves no purpose, none, zero, anymore, because you realize isness is. It's always is, like that. That's the awakening. That's the awakening from the dream. So everybody that's coming to awaken from the dream has been on some side trip. Okay, everybody. Now, in the case of Ananda Mayama, she was not on any side trip, but for the sake of relating to the world, she put herself through all side trips. She said she'd go through side trips like in a second or two, and she said she just went through all the side trips of the world, and so she saw the entirety of the ways that we are getting off onto side trips. And then when people come to her, she'd see exactly what side trip they're on, know exactly what it's all about, and would just then give them exact right advice for their particular situation. But the rest of us are on side trips, have been. So of course we have stuff that is pulling at us and saying, come play with me, you know. Of course we have it, everyone, whatever it may be. And we have to just say, no, wait a minute, no, not now, you know. Whatever is tugging at your cape, say, not now, not right now, maybe later, but not now. I am focusing on awakening from the dream, realizing don't need to do anything, do not need to do anything at all with the dream, in any way, shape, or form. The whole thing, all the trauma, all the death, all the suffering, I don't need to cover that up. I don't need to get rid of the cover-up of it, the whole supposed the good part of the dream that's supposedly doing all those good works. I don't need to get rid of the good works. I don't need to get rid of the ceaseless massacre of the dream. I don't need to get rid of any of the delusions in the dream. I don't need to do anything with the dream, because I realize it is a dream, and it's entirely unnecessary. What has never been threatened by this dream in any way, and never will be. So, don't need it. Don't need the dream. Don't need to be creative in the dream at all. Right? Don't need to make the dream more interesting. Don't need to make the dream, prettier, more beautiful. Don't need to be a beautiful person in the dream. Don't need to be any particular way at all, but be awake from the dream. And that's a whole different thing than being a beautiful person in the dream. You don't have to, be an ugly person in the dream or whatever. It doesn't matter. One way or the other, it doesn't make any difference. If you're awake from the dream, it's that awakeness from the dream that then is conveyed. No matter what side trip you've been on in the past, because again, everyone, with rare exception of those avatars who come into the world who are only coming into the world to help us, and they're not intrinsically on any side trip at all. In other words, they call it no karma. Their birth in this world is not caused by any quote-unquote karma, any side trip, at all. With those rare exceptions, and we're not in that category, we have been on side trips. So, of course, the question of what about the fact I've been on side trips is very important to address. It's not so simple to just say, okay, wake up from the dream. And you think, well, what about all the side trips? Am I okay? The fact I've been on the side trip, is that okay? It's okay, because what you will convey is the awakening from the dream, the fact that you've awakened from the dream, that will be conveyed. And whatever side trip you've been on, it will be inconsequential, super insignificant, super insignificant. Anyone who focuses on that doesn't want to awaken from the dream at all. So it doesn't matter who you've been. In other words, what side trip you've been on, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. It only matters that you have woken up from the dream and you realize you don't need a dream. Reality doesn't need a dream. Reality doesn't need a dream about reality, about anything. It doesn't need any dreams. And so that will be conveyed. And then that will help others, reassure them of getting the right focus, right focus. And so again, this is not attacking any side trip at all. It is saying that all side trips are equally futile and equally inconsequential to reality. And that whatever your side trip is, I'm not judging any one side trip, because everybody has them. Whatever it is, doesn't matter. It could be anything at all. Simply say not now to that side trip. Not now. I need to focus on waking up from this dream. I need to ask myself, am I trying to modify the dream, or am I trying to awaken from the dream? And then realize only awakening from the dream is truly going to give me what I really want. It's only that will free me from the fear, the terror, the trauma of the dream. Okay. And of course, you see a lot of smiling faces in this world. Don't be fooled by the whatever side trips they're on. Maybe a smiley face side trip, right? They went to the orthodontist when they were young, and they loved to show off the pearly whites, and loved to look beautiful and attractive and all this. Okay, that's a side trip. Body beautiful, whatever. That's just a side trip. Just another one, okay? You don't have to, whatever it is, just say, okay, I don't, let's not now to that, not now to that, not now to that, not now to that, not that, not now to that. Whatever. Because again, all equally inconsequential, all equally futile, no consequence whatsoever to reality, to what the isness, no consequence to our ability to experience the isness, to drop the dream. The dream is dropped as a passion. Not a part. The idea that a part of a dream is somehow greater or lesser than the rest of the dream is itself a dream. So you cannot drop part of a dream. You either awaken from the dream or you're still dreaming. Because when you wake from the dream, you realize it was all a dream, and it's all equally untrue. If you haven't realized it's all equally untrue, you're still dreaming. So you can say, well, I've dropped this part, and this part, and this part, so that should be okay. No, it's not okay. Because you haven't realized it's all the dream was equally untrue. There was no part of the dream that was more true than another part. I mean, it was all 100% zero. So how can there be levels in the dream? If you still think there are levels, you're still dreaming. If there are any levels at all, reality doesn't have any levels. Isness doesn't have any levels to it. So if you feel any, levels whatsoever, still dreaming, still on a side trip. Side trip of trying to clarify levels or something. Only in a dream are there levels of any kind. The I am isness is not, doesn't have any levels. Reality doesn't have any levels. It's all equally isness. All of it. Totally. Everything. Reality shares everything with all of reality. There's not any part of reality that has more or less. Everything is 100% isness in reality. So you see, the sun is setting here, which is why I have to keep adjusting these controls to try and brighten it up. It's like the sun is setting on this era, this cycle of the world. It really is. Just like that, we're going towards darkness very quickly. We're going towards a restructuring of civilization on this planet. There are other factors that will also come into play at some point in time. I'm not sure of the time frame. There are cosmic change, which will also take place. But as far as the financial, economic collapse is definitely coming, and the bureaucratic control, central control over people's lives is coming. All of that is coming. That's all in a dream. It's all in a dream. It's all a dream. You can awaken from that dream. You say, I don't need that dream. And again, what after that? Let's not worry too much about that. We've gone into it in other videos. What we want to do here is to push aside the side trips. Don't be thinking, you know what? Maybe I can compose the music for this new restructuring that's going to take place, and I will be the one of the key musicians, the composers who can compose the music that will help us all restructure. Or maybe I can compose the music for the manufacturing plant where all the workers will, dig the music there. Have some muzak. I can compose new muzak to help everybody be happy workers. I guarantee you there are tons of people in the world that's exactly what they're working on. And it certainly has crossed my mind too. I was thinking wow, I could compose some great music. So as the drones are working in their roles, they could hear this music and they would say, catch a breeze of freedom. But the fact is that music also will be vetted. Okay, it's very important for you to realize that the central planners are very aware of music and its effects on us. And they have very carefully categorized music. And, every music's now, the waveforms are all digitized. And they can run algorithms on that, and they know what kind of mood they want to produce, and they can vet all the music, whatever songs, and check the waveforms of all the songs, and very quickly generate playlists for any person in any particular role. So the fact is, your music will be controlled. Think about that. Think about that, all of you. That your music is going to be chosen for you. A lot of people already have these apps that choose their music for them. Like, I don't know, was it, you know what I'm talking about. I don't want to use any specific, point anything out, highlight any particular company, etc. Because I'm trying to get the big picture to you. Already this technology's there, whereas they already know your likes and dislikes, etc. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. The rest of it is that you will have certain roles in society. And they will generate playlists for you that are supposed to inspire you to carry out that role. Think about that. Just imagine that. I mean, wow. That you talk about, if you want to, frighten me, talk about somebody else choosing the music that I want to listen to. I mean, that is, goes over the line big time. Big time. I don't like using any music program at all on the computer. I want to decide which song I want to listen to at any particular moment. I don't want anything suggesting to me what I should listen. I don't want anything controlling my playlist. Oh, no way. Which I don't like, the whole digitization of music. I realize, hey, this is going in a bad direction. It really is. I'm super sensitive to that. I can tell, like, that's, this is trying to manage my musical taste for me. Really. And you know it's been going in that direction severely. So I guarantee you, you won't be able to listen to the music you want to listen to. That'll be a big deal, a really big deal. And you may think you'd be able to sneak it and say, no, they will have ways of monitoring the music you listen to too. The devices that you use will know what songs are playing in the devices. That'll also be tracked. Okay, so you will not be free. You will not even be free to listen to the music you want to listen to. You will not be free to look at the videos you want to look at. Those two will be suggested to you. You'll have a generated playlist of videos for you. About that. So you think that, you know, this is all being sold as like freedom, like a utopia. Just think about it. That automatically you'll have generated for you TV shows and movies and videos, all the kind of stuff that you like. And you won't even have to worry, waste time trying to find what you like, because the computers are already give you what they know you like. But what you don't realize is the central planning, the levels of central planning, will have your profile and your role in society, and they will only give you what they want to give you psychologically to keep you on the straight and narrow, being a drone in the role that they've assigned to you. Movies, television program, entertainment, music, reading, everything that'll be suggested to you as if this is what you really like is really what they really want you to ingest, to keep you as a drone doing what they role they've assigned you to do. So it's a fool's paradise, isn't it? It's a fool's paradise. Frightening, isn't it? If you see the extent that is really going to take place. And they've been doing trial runs and all this, and people are thinking, hey, this is great. You know, I can just let this, you know, playlist go and all these tunes, you know, these songs, and oh, there's a new artist, I like that. Yeah, that's kind of cool. They don't realize they're being prepared for this. They're trying to soften the blow. All this is trying to soften the blow when really the central planning will control your life from A to Z, A to Z. They'll even know how many times you've gone to the bathroom, you know. I mean, everything in your life. How many breaths you've taken, you know. How many whatever, how much food you've eaten. Everything is going to be monitored. And more monitoring is going to be added on as it goes along. So at first you might think, wow, this is severe monitoring. And they'll say, you know, we'll give back, we'll ease up on this. Once all the society, civilization is rebuilt, we'll ease up on it. But in fact, what will happen is it will just be more and more and more and more exponentially until you're like a complete drone. That is what's going to happen. Other things, cosmic things, are going to happen also, where the whole thing is going to be wiped out anyway. But you certainly don't want to go down that road. It's a slippery slope. It's a free fall once you buy into that. So I never bought into any of this stuff. I looked at it, I examined it, I said, whoa, wait a minute. I don't want to get used to anything telling me what is best for me. Everything I choose, I try to let it be chosen for me internally by the grace of God, by the I am, by the isness, the grace of the isness. Let that, as the isness, you choose for me where to go, what to look at, what videos, what music. You know what's best for my awakening as far as gradually coming to that point where I'm able to put the dream down. So you know what will help cancel out my whatever resistance I have. So you do that for me and try to have faith in that. And the stuff I come upon, there's two kinds of guidance in the world now. You know, it always has been. There's the guidance of the muses who are trying to get you to modify the dream, and there's a guidance of the I am isness, which is helping, grace is helping you get to the point where you choose to awaken from the dream. So there's really two types of guidance, and you can try to follow both of those both, but those end up, you know, seeming like canceling each other out. So you have to decide, you know, what guidance are you going to use. If you're going along with this whole computer generated thing, preferences, and you know, people are letting it be known what shows they watch, you know, their viewing habits, their habits about everything, that's all getting you ready to get into this one world dictatorship, central planning to try and rebuild a new civilization on this planet. To, in other words, come up from the ashes of the collapse and to be the heroes of the new, that's always the heroes. I mean, China collapsed, you know, when Mao and Chiang Kai-shek were fighting and you know, China was in just chaos. It collapsed, you know. It was really out of the ashes of that collapse came the new, you know, new China. And with their, you know, drone-like mentality. And it was presented as, you're the heroes of the revolution, you're the heroes of the new civilization, you're going to rule the world, you're the heroes, you're the ones who are doing it. And people just, you know, wow, we are like gods, you know, we are literally giving rebirth to a new, something new and vastly better. So it's a very intoxicating type of, you know, propaganda. What they didn't realize is they're being turned into drones. And at this point, you know, they're getting this feeling like, hey, we want more freedom. But what that will be channeled into is the freedom to control everybody else. Okay, you have all these people who are used to being controlled, and they're now feeling like, hey, you know, I want a little more freedom. And what the freedom that they will be given is the freedom to work on controlling others. That is a fact. Like a lot of people in the U.S. wouldn't have any idea how to control others. I don't have any idea how to do that. I don't have no desire. I can't even run a business because I have no desire to control someone else. I just say, hey, you're free. Do whatever you want to do. Do whatever you want to do. You want to show up? Show up. You don't want to show up? Don't show up. It's your life. You're free. Do as you are internally guided to do. If you want to say this, you're free to that, say that. You want to. So how could I comply with any bureaucracy or law in a workplace? It's impossible. I wouldn't fire somebody for something. I couldn't. I'm not going to control their lives. They're free. They're free. Their lives are free. And so, you know, no way could I participate in any central planning effort. I just tell everybody, hey, you know, I always joke, if someone made me boss, I'd say, guess what? You're all free to do whatever you want to do. I fire myself from a boss job. First thing I do is, if I'm boss, I'll fire myself. But there are many who have grown up in totalitarian central bureaucracy planning where they're completely used to this and feel this is superior because they get more done, they get more manufacturing done, they get able to generate all this stuff, this junk. And material stuff. And so for them, they think it's completely right to control. Everyone should be controlled. They should have central planning, and the central planning should be over the entire planet. Okay? And so they're very eager to make sure that everybody is controlled and turned into drones. And at the same time, they're chafing a little bit under it. So they want to, you know, be given more responsibility. So here it is, handed to them on a silver platter. Here you go. You get to control all these people in the world, you know, who are desperate to rebuild, you know, their civilization. They want to do it. So all the pieces are in place. And yet we can awaken from the dream. Don't have to go through all that stuff. You know, once you awaken from the dream, you realize the I am presence of the I am isness is really completely functional. And from that standpoint, the I am isness can, if you want it, if it wants to, can dream, not dream, I'm sorry, the I am isness can manifest a universe, a world, worlds, universe, or a tapestry of experiencing that doesn't even have the, doesn't need a world or universes, can do all of that. Boom, like that. Just says to the mind, mind, this is what I want. Boom, like that, in an instant. So those who are awakened from the dream, if they want another world, boom. If that's what they want, not a problem. So that the complete genius of reality can provide whatever it is you want. You say, okay, how can I, if I don't want to be part of this central, one world, new world order, centralized bureaucracy, everybody assigned roles, you know, everyone turned into drones. If I don't want that, and I awaken from the dream, can I have something else? Of course, of course. Instantly, piece of cake, manifest. The mind instantly can manifest whatever you want. That is, you know, not a problem whatsoever. But again, that's not our focus, because it is beyond our imagining. In a dream, and once we're, when it's dream, we can't imagine how it's possible. But we can awaken from the dream. I need to point out the consequences of not awakening from the dream are very drastic right now. Being turned into a drone, or a central planner drone, part of the central planning for everybody else, controlling everybody else, telling them exactly, you know, working on all the software and electronic gadgets that we used. Everybody will be, you know, branded in some way, all the data collected. It's a massive undertaking, and everybody will be regimented, told what they can do, what they can eat, what kind of movies they can watch, what kind of entertainment, everything, everything. No stone unturned, no stone unturned. You won't be able to view these videos at that point. No way. No way. You won't even be able to view them on some device. Devices are going to have stuff built into them. Now, at this point, we still have a certain amount of freedom. We think, ah, that's crazy. But in the back of our mind, we know that these devices, these capabilities are there. It's just the laws are saying you can't use them. Like, you know, tracking your smartphone, where you've been, even listening in on what you're saying. You know, they're devices, they're ways, they're apps that can track you, everything you do. They're just not using them, but they're there. The technology's there. The manufacturing can be there in a snap like that. And at some point, once a dictator gets powers, and the dictator can simply decree executive order, saying, okay, we're going to put these devices in every gadget, in your computer, etc. So if you think you're watching a video, like on your home, you know, something, that will be wireless, that will be monitored somehow. They will know what you're looking at. If it's something that's not tagged with some, you know, you're watching something untagged, whatever it is, that's a violation. Everything will have some kind of, you know, digital tag to it, whatever you're watching, and it will register, that digital tag will register that you are watching that, that is being watched on your device, and that you, what you're being chipped, will also register who the viewer is too. Okay, that will register in the gadget that is you're watching it on, and that will be sent to central data, to your profile, and stored there. And so if something is if there's under gadgets unlicensed or unmarked, it'll register something's being unmarked, or you might not even be able to watch anything that's unmarked or listen to anything that doesn't have that digital code to it. You won't be able to. The device will not work for you. Will not work. Now sure, there'll be, you know, black market stuff, but that'll be cracked down on very badly, and there'll be like old stuff, you know, you might be able to watch an old DVD player, etc. But they'll have ways to monitor all that and crack down on. And another thing is that the young people, those, not, you know, mostly young people who feel this is all pretty okay because they don't have not grown up in freedom so much, they're training them just like the communist Chinese trained young people from cradle to be informers on the older people. The exact same thing is taking place here on a subtle level, that the young people are been trained to look for certain things and the willingness to inform on it. So if you're using some old technology that's not chipped, and it doesn't have the capability to determine the code on anything that you're watching, the digital signature of anything, they will inform. They will inform, they'll say, hey, my parents have all this, you know, old technology, and they're able to watch these videos that don't have the ID code on them, and they're cheating. They're cheating the system, they're cheating, they're not getting with the program, and you'll be turned in. I mean, in China, the young people turned in the old people across the board. The older people lived in terror of these young people, the informants. And of course, some older people were informants too. But it was a lot was the children. Children informed on the parents, big time. And parents live in terror of the children. And you see that whole dynamic taking place in the United States now, in Western countries, is that the parents are living in terror of their children, because the children can say, well, you know, they hit me, they slapped me, they bullied me, they threatened me, you know, they did something, you know, and social services can come in like stormtroopers and remove the child from that situation. You know, severe criminal penalties can be applied, and it's almost like a he said she said thing, or the child said, yeah, they did this, and the parents said, no, we did not, you know, and then they'll believe the child. So already this whole dynamic of the older generation living in terror of the younger generation is in place, and the older generation is getting very much used to complying with whatever the younger generation tells them to do. They say, oh, okay, what, did I do something wrong? Oh, I'm sorry. Did I make some slur or some statement or some joke, or, you know, did I say something that is not acceptable? Oh my gosh, don't tell anybody, you know. Don't tell your teacher, don't tell your friends. You know, I'll get in big trouble. That's already in place. Elder people living in terror of the younger people, because we come from a time of greater freedom. We didn't have any PC police in our time. No way. We were encouraged to challenge authority. We were encouraged to challenge norms. We were encouraged to be tolerant of different viewpoints. We were encouraged, and we didn't say, well, this is, you know, phobic of this and bigot, all racist, bigot, all, you know, all this stuff. You say, well, wait a minute, you know, let's just have the freedom of everybody to see as they see, view as they view, look deeper, share with others. Let us not condemn anyone's viewpoint. Let's not criminalize any viewpoint, you see, because we knew that that is a road to central planning dictatorship, all in the name of so-called tolerance, you know. Now, real tolerance is to tolerate, be willing to tolerate viewpoints that you find offensive, but still say, you know, defend their right to express that viewpoint, because that viewpoint can change also. But people have to feel that they're empowered, they have the right to at least whatever they think is in the dream, before they can really feel empowered to let go of the dream altogether for true isness. If you keep attacking what people think is isness in the dream, you're just going to make things worse. So we lived in a time where it was acceptable, you know, we didn't feel like threatened by our thoughts and our ideas and our opinions and our perspectives, that it might rub someone the wrong way. The idea of taking offense at stuff was ridiculous. You know, I can hardly imagine, you know, I never had anyone, you know, say, took offense at something I said or someone else said, taking offense at it. Yeah, we might, you know, say, ah, shut up, you know, and back and forth. There's some back and forth. That's it, you know. And it's not like someone said, oh my God, I took so much offense. That kind of thing. Not really. People manage to get along. Surprisingly so. The fiction of today is that in the past it was all some terribly prejudiced, horrible, intolerant society. It's not true. That's a lie. Big lie. It's absolutely not true. In fact, the people were much smarter back then. Much, much smarter, much happier, more friendly. They had their act together much better back then. Way more capable. Those are facts. And there wasn't this, you know, it wasn't nearly as horrendous as those who are going towards this dictatorship, New World Order dictatorship, are trying to paint it. They're trying to demonize the past. What they're demonizing is freedom. They're trying to say, oh, society back then was so terrible and intolerant, so oppressive, and all these victims and blah 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 blah. It wasn't really like that. Sure, there were people who were on the outside. They had their own society. They had their own culture, countercultures. There were a lot of countercultures, subcultures. All that stuff was going on. And we didn't feel a need, you know, to say, wait a minute, everything's got to be mainstream, etc. And there wasn't, you know, there's in any society, there's going to be problems. Okay, it wasn't perfect by any means, but it isn't remotely like it's portrayed now by the revisionists, those who are hell-bent on moving us all towards this dictatorship, trying to make us think that the past was some horrible, horrible place, and we were all just, you know, nasty, intolerant bigots, and we should be super grateful to embrace this this central bureaucracy assigning us all these roles, and we'll become much better people, and we'll build a much better world in that terrible, nasty place. It was terrible and nasty the way existence is always terrible and nasty, you know. Always. It was in that way. But as far as, you know, the people were concerned, my gosh, people were so much more civil back then. Way more civil. Way more kind. Way more compassionate. Way more helpful. Way more understanding. You know, whatever you were, there was an understanding. Okay. You know, there was more heart back then. There was more true compassion, even though it may have been, you know, seem, you know, a bit rough and tumble and not sophisticated, etc. Now, it's amazing how revisionists have managed to paint a false picture of the past and demonize it. That's part of the central planning. I mean, if you want to get everybody into the pen, into the cattle cars, and into dronism, you make it seem like the past, it was some, you know, horrible, terrible, awful, you know, place where everybody was discriminated against. There was no freedom whatsoever, and we're the ones that are leading, give you the real freedom. No, not true at all. Not true. Completely deceptive, half lies, half truths, distortions, all that kind of stuff. Again, in existence is brutal. It's merciless. It's not fair, you know. And yet, at that time, there was so much more of a sweeter spirit than there is now. Unbelievable. I mean, the kind of incivility that we experience now, the lack of concern for people, for their freedom, for all that stuff, is off the charts compared to what it used to be. Off the charts. The barbaric nature of the world now. The world is way more barbaric than it used to be. And yet everybody's under this delusion that it's way more progressive than it used to be, which is completely false. What we're progressing towards is the dictatorship, the central planning. We're progressing towards central planning, and many feel that that is a way better way to do things. But it's an attempt to create a utopia. It is an attempt to modify the dream, which, as I've pointed out, is simply not the goal that anyone here actually has. The goal is to awaken from the dream. Because the dream is completely futile, complete waste of time. The goal is to awaken from the dream, not to try and modify it. So all this central planning stuff is a super radical attempt to modify the dream. And many think, oh, that'll do it. We'll be happy then. No, you will not. You will still have this incredible burden on you. Incredible burden. You'll still be attracted back to the isness. You'll have a massive wall of terror and fear and revulsion of it, thinking that this is going back into some, you know, hideous situation. And you will be brainwashed and into a condition of feeling terrorized by the very notion of isness. And you will literally put yourself into another cycle of existence, in another long period of Maya, of dreaming, continue dreaming for another long cycle before you try to work through all this fear, this brainwashing that's taken place. I've seen the brainwashing that's taken place through the popular media culture. It's incredible, incredibly heavy, and it will become much more heavy in the future. All under the guise of freedom. under the guise of giving you what you really want. You know, you'll get the music you really want because we have all these algorithms that know exactly what your tastes are, etc. Except they say, but you've been re-educated now, and here's what you really want to do because you really want to carry out this program because our computers tell you this is what you really want to do. It's actually what they want you to do. And what they see that you can do to further the objectives of building a perfect society, a perfect culture, a perfect civilization, or are super advanced, supposedly. But the one thing that's entirely lacking from this is the awakening from the dream, the realization that all attempts to modify the dream are equally futile, completely meaningless and inconsequential. That is lacking from this. So basically, the war on religion is really a war on removing this central truth of awakening from the dream. That is being, they're moving towards getting rid of that entirely. And so they want to replace all the religions of the world with one world religion, which is all based on modifying the dream. They want to twist it all and turn it into your purpose is to modify the dream. They want to program all the drones. Your purpose is to modify the dream. If I had dark sunglasses on, I'd probably look like Bono. And everybody'd say, whoa, wow, yeah, what you're saying must be true. Modify the dream. Yeah, that's what we're here for. You know, but no, I don't have the dark sunglasses on. So I'm saying awaken from the dream. Awaken from the dream. And again, not to single out Bono, but that's just a popular culture icon. And the idea is the same. The same thing. Whether either you're working on modifying the dream or you're working on awakening from the dream. And don't get the two confused. Don't get the two confused. And how do you know don't get them confused? By listening to those who don't have them confused. By paying attention to books, to teachings, to videos, to everything that is given out by those who are not confused about the two. That is how you get helped and get boosted, and clarification is provided and helpful for you. That's how. Plus your own inner knowing. But if all of that is gone, it's all gone, it's all wiped out, no longer available for you, how are you going to get that? You're going to get easily confused. Easily confused. Central planners are very adept at what they're doing. It's, the central planning that's coming on this world is not only from this world, it's actually also being contributed to from other civilizations, other planets, other areas. They're coming in to assist in this mind control and central planning because they're so-called experts in building better worlds, better civilizations, better experts in modifying the dreams. So they're coming in to help in this so-called great endeavor. But this great endeavor is extreme folly. Extreme folly. It only makes it more fearful. The idea of awakening from the dream will be more fearful. And since it becomes more fearful, the time spent in delay will be longer. And all time spent in existence is merciless. And the purpose of existence is to generate trauma, suffering, trauma, and death. And you will suffer all of that. The amount of trauma as you put on a smiley face, and you may think that you may put on an image of happiness. I meant to say previously in the video that these smiley face people, they're acting like, oh, what me worry? I don't have any trauma. Don't worry, be happy. No trauma here. You know, you've seen the video like of Don't Worry, Be Happy, and all these people, all this terrible stuff's happening to them, and they're just singing, don't worry, be happy, you know. All this drama's happening. They lose this, they lose this, they lose this, and they're penniless, they're going to starve, and they're going to, you know, go through all this privation, they're going to die, trauma, et cetera, and then they say, don't worry, be happy, you know. Anyway, I'm still smiling, man. You know, it's all good. All good. That kind of nonsense, you know, put on a smiley face and pretend that you're not suffering trauma is just utter folly, because you are suffering trauma on every level of existence. It's nothing but trauma. It's nothing but vulnerability. That's not happy. That's not fun. That's not cool. Vulnerability is not fun. That we don't really want vulnerability, because that vulnerability is actually symbolizing, imagining vulnerability of isness. Okay, and that's terrifying to us. It's terrifying. So all these people with the smiley faces inside, they're terrified. They're terrified. You can tell the difference between a smiley face and someone who's awoken from the dream who is smiling. It's a different smile. It's a different smile. It's a different carefreeness. You know, we're sold this image of carefreeness, you know. Have some gum and a soft drink and a beautiful face and a big smile and, you know, and sing a jingle and life is happy. And people say, wow, yeah, I can be carefree too. All I got to do is buy this soda. Buy the soft drink, drink the gum, get a makeover, get some braces, get some nice fashion going, you know, and I can be carefree too. And we all, you know, jump into that. Try to be carefree, and that's not carefreeness. They're those within, they are terrified, they're traumatized. The existence is traumatizing them on every level possible. If you start looking at it, you realize, yeah, traumatized. We see people driving in their cars, like in the, you know, all the car commercials. They try to make the seem like driving is some can be a carefree experience, right? An awesome carefree experience. You're just, you know, sliding. You know, and then the guy's just sitting there like, yeah, this is cool. Going through glass. I mean, going all this stuff in cars. You know, they're geniuses at that. They're portraying that. Get in this car, and you will be carefree. You will really be carefree. No matter what happens, you're carefree. Fact is, you get in a car and you're traumatized. Absolutely traumatized. I drive every day. A lot. And it's severe trauma every single day. Because you have to look out for everybody. Not only do you have to look out for all their cars. You have to look out for all construction workers, road crews. You have to look out for all road hazards. You have to look out for all animals that could jump on your way. You have to look out for all pedestrians, all skateboarders, all bicyclists. Okay, pedestrians. You have to look out for all unexpected situations. You have to look out for your own driving, your own car. You have to be worried about blowouts. You have to be worried about hitting something. I mean, it goes on and on. The weather. You have to worry about the gasoline. Will your car, you know, keep working? You know, it's just an extremely traumatic thing. And you know, you've got people who are distracted all the time. I had somebody coming at me yesterday in a two-lane road. They just pulled over right in my lane, coming straight at me head on, trying to do something. I had no idea what, and I had to just go over the shoulder. It turns out they were thinking that my lane was a turn lane to make a left turn, and it wasn't a turn lane. It was only the one and only lane I had. So fortunately, they kind of saw me coming. They said, oh my gosh, what's going on? And they slowed down, and I went around the shoulder and was able to get around them. And they were just like, oh my gosh, yeah, what'd I do? I saw as I passed by, hit the horn, and said, wow, you just, you know, could have caused a head-on accident. Stuff like that happens all the time. That, you know, super traumatic, could have been dead. So this idea of getting in a car and, you know, be carefree is totally insane. Totally delusional, completely false. Advertising is such a deceiver. It is such a deceiver, and advertisers get more and more and more sophisticated. And central planning knows how to advertise so incredibly well. They're so smart and clever at it. And the techniques, the mind control and advertising, all that stuff is so sophisticated, it's ridiculous. Yeah, it can get everybody. It really can. Really can. It's ridiculous to think that you're invulnerable to it. The only way to be invulnerable to it is to awaken from the dream. Otherwise, you'll be vulnerable to being manipulated. Absolutely. Carefreeness is power. Carefreeness, attractiveness. All this stuff is being marketed to us. It's all nonsense. Existence is nothing but trauma. If you really are honest, you know, just drive and you start realizing, holy cow, you know. We have bicyclists all over the place here. And that is really a dangerous thing. Because the bike lanes here are insufficient. So they're always out in the road. And you have to go around them into the oncoming lane. And you have kids wobbling on their bicycles to school. Groups of them, you know, and they're joking and laughing. You got to slow down to 5 miles an hour, 10, just in case one of these kids might veer or fall off their bike, because everyone's, you know, fooling around. You got skateboards, my gosh, you got people skateboarding at night in black clothes, you never even see them. I almost ran over a skateboard a couple times where they just suddenly just ran right out in front of my car, chasing after their skateboard they fell off of. You know, crazy stuff, kids. And you got to drive super defensively. You have to drive as if you could cause trauma to someone at any point, which is how I drive. Looking out for the everybody else out there, just to make sure I don't cause any trauma. I make sure I don't run over any squirrel, you know, that jumps in the road, or any cat or any dog or anything. Make sure you don't cause any harm when you're driving. And that's tremendous responsibility and tremendous focus, and you got to drive from the heart, which means I don't want to cause trauma to anybody. And when you drive from the heart, you will avoid all those accidents, you avoid all that stuff, but still it puts you in a state of feeling, you know, the trauma, vulnerabilities everywhere. You got to realize the vulnerability of everything in order to make sure you don't, you know, cause troubles. I've avoided all sorts of accidents. I've avoided all sorts of situations that could have harmed other people. Not my fault. Crazy stuff. Really crazy stuff. My gosh. I was on a freeway once. There was a construction zone. A lane was closed. It was coned off. There was two highway patrol officers with their backs turned to the oncoming traffic. And somebody, everyone got over in the left lanes, and the right lane was coned off, and there was construction work going on. And somebody, I suddenly looked over to my right, and there was this car in the construction zone, headed right toward these CHP officers, and there was no way for him to get in to the left where I was, because the traffic was like almost bumper to bumper, and he was running out of space to hit the brakes, and the CHP officers had their backs turned to him, and I saw this in a flash, and I said, oh my God, he's going to run them over, both of them over. And I hit my brakes behind in the flash, boom, boom, eased my brakes, and he slipped in front of me, poof, just before, you know, he would hit the officers, poof, like that, and they never even knew, you know, what happened. But I was driving with awareness. I said, okay, oh my gosh, and see the whole thing, say, do something, and so that kind of driving, you know, you save lives, probably save two lives. And people do that all the time. You drive, people who drive with awareness, they've probably saved my life in certain circumstances. I realized that people saw the trouble I was in on the road, and they stopped, you know, or back, you know, accelerate or something, let me in. So you drive with heart like that, you save lives. But the vulnerability is still there. That was a horrible situation, my gosh. Holy cow. I don't want to say who was driving that vehicle, but they had no idea of the norms of driving on our freeways here. And that you see those cones, you know. They were just oblivious to the cones and everything. They were just driving along like, and then suddenly just before they got there, it's like, wow, uh-oh. You know, it's crazy stuff. So this carefree notion of carefreeness is absolutely nonsense. Absolute nonsense. The isness is carefree, because there's no threat to the isness. There's no threat to the life of isness at all. Isness is not a body. It's not a form. Okay, it's an essence. It's a presence. It is. It's the isness itself. So the isness can't be run over. But while we're in this world, the notion of a carefree world is ludicrous. And all this advertising is so misleading and deceptive, because it makes us feel that pursuing that car is going to give us that carefreeness that only isness can give us, but only awakening from the dream can give us. That's the only thing that can give us this true carefree. And yet we think these material things can give us this house, this spouse, this car, these clothes, this look, this jewelry, these accessories, this job, this travel, this vacation, this place, these friends, this food, these things, these gadgets, and on and on and on and on and on. We think those can give us carefree life. Those can give us happiness. That's a lie. It's a total folly. Only someone who's deeply into dreaming, you know, could not see through this. It's obvious. And yet they're playing upon our desire for carefreeness and our fear of awakening from the dream to misguide us, misdirect us into chasing after materialism, things that we think will provide this feeling of carefreeness. And there's a whole industry, you know, in doing that, of stars, you know, stars are showing us the way, you know, superheroes, all these superheroes saying, hey, you know, you can have superpowers in the dream. And you don't have to be careful. Yeah, you get rid of all the bad guys and girls, but you yourself will be invulnerable. You know, that kind of stuff too. All nonsense. The dream is a dream of trauma, a dream of negation, a dream of loss, a dream of suffering, a dream of death, a dream of sickness. All this other stuff is just camouflaging it. It's a dream of vulnerability. It's a dream of vulnerability. So as long as you're dreaming, you will be dreaming a dream of vulnerability. It doesn't matter what car you're driving. It does not matter. Of course, it's good to have a safe car. Very good. Nothing wrong with that. That doesn't mean it's carefree. It just means that when someone plows into you, you know, maybe you'll survive. Nothing wrong with that. I'm not against anything necessarily, you know, that is common sense-wise. Can help out, but this idea that somehow we can be protected from vulnerability in the dream is insanity. You know, it's just, let's just, you know, pass all these laws. Anybody who has any problem in the dream, they say, oh, okay, let's pass a law, let's make it illegal. You know, they're trying to outlaw vulnerability, in other words, which is impossible, completely nuts. And yet we think, hey, that's a good thing. Yeah, let's just outlaw all of this stuff. Let's just outlaw, pass more laws, whatever is unsafe, you know. You could like say, well, somebody had an accident in a car, and you could say, let's outlaw cars because cars are dangerous, you know. But not having a car is also very dangerous. But pretty soon they will have cars that drive themselves. I go on the freeways all the time. I see these Google cars, self-driving cars all the time. And that is their goal. Their goal is actually to have cars drive themselves. So, of course, wherever you go will be monitored, right? Exactly. You want any freedom to even drive your own car? Think about that. Think about that. You start going somewhere not supposed to go, the car won't go there. Think about that. You got assigned a role by central planning. You get in your car in the morning, and the car drives you to work. Get out of work, get in the car, drives you back home. You think, wow, I'm living a carefree life. No worries, I don't even have to drive anymore. Let's say you wanted to drive, you know, to some satsang, if there were any such a thing in the future. Car won't take you there. Let's say somebody else's car. No, their car won't take them there either, because their car is programmed too. So this whole self-driving car thing also is to deprive you of freedom of where you want to go. Everything will be pre-programmed into the car, downloads, you know, where, okay, this is where the car can take you, and you can maybe petition, I want to go see a movie or something, they'll say, and they'll check about your preferences. Okay, you're allowed to go see this movie. So your car then will be given the okay to take you to the, you know, the movie theater and then bring you back home again. But you want to go for a, you know, out to a restaurant? Well, you have to program that in ahead of time also and get permission to do that too. That's where we're headed. We're almost there. It'll happen faster than anyone can believe, because once the financial, worldwide financial economic structure collapses, then all this stuff will be mainline, what do you call it? Streamlined. Not streamlined. We'll be sent to the front, you know. We'll be pushed through really fast. There's a word for that. It'll happen. Boom, 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 boom. So everyone's like, oh my gosh, we got to do this. We just got to do it. And we'll just throw away any resistance, reluctance they have. And we'll be, oh, it'll be fast-tracked. That's the word I'm looking for. It'll all be fast-tracked. Totally fast-tracked, and all these sort of legalistic, you know, lawsuits, all this stuff, gone. The dictator will just say, no more lawsuits for any of this stuff. No more. And, you know, everything will be ruled by decree, executive decree, and bureaucracy, and they just decide, this is what we're doing, You won't be able to sue to stop it. You can't say, hey, you know, I'm going to have a lawsuit to block this from happening. No such thing will happen. Will not happen. You cannot do that. Because your role is not to be any plaintiff. They didn't assign you the role of plaintiff. Remember, you have an assigned role. No one will be assigned a role of being a plaintiff. And the lawyers will all be giving jobs, helping in this vetting process of you know, helping assign people where they are and make sure that everything is everyone does everything they're supposed to do. It's easy for them to transition into a central planning type of situation. But there won't be any lawsuits at all. So as you're driving in your car to work, not you're driving, as the car is being driven for you to work, automatically, self-driving, it also is playing the music that you want to watch, and you'll be able to watch videos or movies you want. Everybody's saying, wow, that is so cool, I love the future. The car will be driven for me, be self-driving, I'll have the music I want, or I can also, any entertainment I want, I'll be sitting there in the seat, and I can spend my commute watching a movie I want. How fabulous is that? Incredible, I love this world. Yeah. But remember, it's all being chosen for you. And of course, people think, wow, all this work of choosing stuff for me, myself, is so difficult. I don't want, you know, to keep doing that. This is easier. Just have the computer choose for me. Oh, yeah. And you never know what I'm going to get that way. You know, get some surprises in the box. Some surprise in the Cracker Jack box. How cool is that? Yeah, so everybody's thinking, this is really cool. I can't wait till I get chipped. I can't wait for their self-driving cars. I can't wait for everything, all my playlists, all my choices are made for me. I can't wait until I'm assigned a job that I'm going to be really good at. Yeah, the central planning will be able to give me exactly the job that I've always really wanted. I'll really thrive and I'll be happy, very happy. And all that kind of stuff. And you're probably your spouse will be chosen for you. How many children will be chosen for you? Their names, you know, chosen for you. Everything will be. And you think, this is better than I could ever do for myself, right? Yeah. But it's leaving out the grace of God, the grace of isness, calling to you, attracting you, and helping you make choices that free you from the dream, that bring you closer to overcoming your fear of awakening from the dream. There's a choice that's going to be made in that way, too. What happens is the isness says, take a look at the broad spectrum here, you know. Look at all this stuff. Is that what you really want? And you say, no. But if you don't have any freedom, how can you do that? How can you evaluate the totality of the dream if you don't have any freedom? I had total freedom. I go to the library, I could look at any book I wanted to. I could check out any book I wanted to. I could look at any movie I wanted to. I could look at any channel I wanted to. I could listen to any music I wanted to. I could go wherever I wanted to. I had complete freedom to do all of that stuff. So I was able to get an overview of everything. I could read, you know, could consider any art I wanted to. Nobody ever could tell me what I could pay attention to. So I was able to get a complete overview of the dream and see, okay, there's nothing here I really want. Get a realization. And you get a realization of the planning of all the propaganda, how they do it, movies and music and all that stuff. I know how they do it. I was able to look at all of that. You're free to examine the totality of the dream and to recognize a dream for what it is. It's just a dream. It is an attempt, a hypothetical scenario attempt to construct, create a new power that Prime Creator didn't create. A power over reality, a power over Prime Creator. That's a power that's more powerful than any of the powers that Prime Creator created. A power that can destroy all the powers that Prime Creator created. A power that can therefore threaten the Prime Creator. That is what existence is attempting to do. This dream is attempting to do that. And if you can get an overview of the whole thing, then you can say, wow, well, there's nothing here I really want. And then you can listen to the song of awakening, as it were. I don't mean some music awakening. I mean the attraction. Saying the song of awakening is a poetic way of talking about it. We don't actually mean that you're hearing some song. But you listen to that, say, that's better than music. The scent of freedom is better than music. You know, I'm attracted, more attracted to this than anything in the world, anything in the dream. But if you're a little drone in a little cubicle and everything is being chosen for you, how can you possibly know that there's nothing out there that that you really want. You don't want what you have. You don't want anything out there, anywhere. You won't be able to know that. Because everything will be chosen for you. Whatever you're experiencing is chosen for you. You don't have any freedom to do a true investigation. You don't have any freedom to do a true vetting. You can't vet existence. You can't vet central planning. You can't vet the bureaucrats. You can't do any vetting at all. You can't dig into anything at all. And you already see that in the media of today where they're getting us prepared for that. Say, no vetting is allowed, you know, of the central planning. Central planners, no vetting is allowed. You're not allowed to know anything about them whatsoever. You might as well treat them as gods. They're your new gods, literally. I mean, the gods of the dream, new gods, they're the ones who's choosing everything for you. They're going to tell you everything, your life, every facet of your life, every facet they will choose for you. They will have the programs and they'll say, this is what you really want. This is what's best for you. We know what's best for you. You can't vet them at all. So, now is the time, you know, we should have used our time wisely to vet the world, vet the dream, vet existence. Be your own investigative reporter, which is what I was. I mean, I was a super investigative reporter on the existence, on the dream. I looked at everything. I dug into it entirely, found out everything. That's being a true investigative reporter. You won't be allowed to do that in the future. You won't be allowed to be an investigative reporter. Forget it. You won't be able to investigate anything. If you try to investigate anything, boom, red flag. You're in a re-education camp again. And they say, gee, we need to find some, reevaluate this person because they're not carrying out their role properly. And either you go along with their propaganda and repent from your so-called sins and get back into what they choose for you, or else you'll be deemed incorrigible. And then bye-bye. Probably harvest your organs is what they'll probably do, tell you the truth. Organ harvesting is a very, very big thing. Will be a huge thing in the future. Those who are incorrigibles, well, some of the people who are good drones need a new liver, need some new kidneys, need a new heart, need some stem cells, all this stuff. The incorrigibles, their bodies will simply be used, harvested for all these various parts. And then people will then say, well, at least we respect the incorrigibles that they contributed to the great society we're building. You know, you'll die a hero because, you know, all your body parts will be utilized to keep the drones alive, functioning better. So how about that? Isn't that something to look forward to? Die a hero of the dream. It's better to awaken from the dream than to try to be a hero of the dream, because sometimes being a hero of the dream is not such a good thing. In fact, it never is. And we have to laugh at this stuff because it is pathetic, you know? We're not laughing in you know, the humor has to be seen because of the complete insanity and madness and patheticness of the dream. It is completely pathetic. And that's what is, we have to laugh at it, because this type of laughter does help awaken from the dream. It moves us closer. We can look at the dream and just say, that is really funny. It is completely pathetic. How absurd can you possibly be? How completely gruesome? How completely insane? How completely madcap? What a totally insane farce it is. How funny that is, you know. From this, in awakening from the dream, the isness can have we can have a good laugh. You know, can say, that was really hilariously stupid, crazy. Okay, that's enough of that now. That kind of thing. So don't forget to laugh at the complete madness of the dream. You know, as we talk about the gruesome details of the future, don't be afraid to laugh. And because you say, hey, I'm going to awaken from it. So, no. Yeah, it's almost like, ha ha, thank God I'm not going to be part of that. You know, relief. There's some relief in the laughter, too, in seeing it. Say, wow, I don't think I want to stick around and have my organs harvested. I don't, you know, because you won't be able to carry out any investigations in the future. No way. How can you carry out an investigation of Dear Leader, you know, or any of the central planners? Cannot do it. We know the model is already there for us in China, but it will be way more sophisticated and way more intolerant. way more severe. But the model is there. We know you can't say anything about dear leader, or your children will go down and tell the block superintendent, you know, whatever. Hey, guess what my parents said, you know. And of course, in today's world, everyone will have a smartphone and be able to record. Everything will be recorded, actually, that in your house, what you're saying, conversations. They say, here we go. We got the conversation right here. Click. There it is. And of course, if they don't like you, they can digitally manufacture any recording they want of you. They can say, here's the evidence. This is what you said, even though you didn't say it at all. They can computer generated effects and all this stuff. They can have you doing things and saying things you never did or never said. They just can make a digital clone of you and make a digital movie of you saying, look, you did this, when in fact you didn't do it at all. And then they'll have a court case, and maybe they'll, you know, justice will look at, well, obviously, here's the evidence right here. How can you possibly say you didn't? The fact you're denying this is just more evidence that you're incorrigible. And then, there you go, into the dustbin of history, and organs harvested. Piece of cake. That's the kind of thing that will happen. Manufactured evidence. Manufactured evidence is coming. If you become too incorrigible, manufactured evidence. You know, ironclad. Here's the proof. Proof. You did this. You said this. Case closed. And of course, all totally fair. Like, hey, we have the proof. Trial, boom. Why do we need any, you know, a trial? Here's the evidence. The evidence is incontrovertible. So that's it. You're done. You're toast. So welcome to the brave new world. There was a book by Aldous Huxley. Hard to say that first name, isn't it? Aldous Huxley. I can't say it. Brave New World. And of course, George Orwell, 1984. All those kind of things. We were raised on those kind of things. We were educated to say, hey, this is what the future's going to be. Look out. Don't get caught in it. Look out. And then also given spiritual books that helped us out a lot. And of course, the double Orwellian world is upon us. The Brave New World is upon us. And it's way worse than they even could have imagined at that time. The double speak is unbelievable. Right now, the incompetence of people, the more incompetent they are, the more people see this incompetence, the more those who see the incompetence are being labeled as crazy, lunatic, fringe, nut jobs, wing nuts, all this kind of stuff. Insane, the more they're labeled. So in other words, seeing the incompetence is evidence of itself of your insanity, because obviously these people can't be incompetent. They're perfect. So it's like, you know, the emperor has no clothes. Whoever sees that the emperor has no clothes, they must be the insane ones. They must be the lunatic fringe or something. That's where we're at right now. That's double Orwellianism, you know. It's projection. It's insanity. It's saying, no, the problem lies in you not being able to see the greatness. You know, the emperor has no clothes, and you see it, and they say, no, your problem is you can't see the clothes. They're there, but you must be insane because you can't see them. Right? That's where we're at right now. That's where we're at. Not a good place for those who cherish sanity, is it? Not a good place at all. It's almost like you have to worship incompetence. You have to worship stupidity. You have to worship dictatorialness. You have to worship. You say, oh yeah, this is great. Wow, they know exactly what they're doing. This is good for me. This is exactly what I want. To appear to be sane. To appear to be sane in this world, you really have to be extremely self-destructive, and you have to be embracing droneness to an extraordinary extent right now. You have to be literally running, sprinting in that direction to be seen as a sane member of society. If you're dragging your heels, you know, and you're complaining, you're being dragged along the road like my parents dragging their kid by the hair, you know, the kids are kicking and screaming, then they'll say, oh boy, this is a malcontent. This is a bad, incorrigible malcontent. They're insane. They're suffering from all sorts of, you know, terrible mental complexes and bigotry and hatred and all this kind of stuff. And wow, they're just not going to make it, are they? Gotta look out for them. So that is the problem. The more you see how bad the direction is, the more you are going to be labeled that you're the bad one. We're already there. We're rushing there, ever-increasing speed. It's getting very dark now, as is the lighting on this video. It's getting very dark. We're going headlong into that. Headlong. You know, there are some people who think they can manipulate any system, and they're the ones that are kind of nonchalanting the situation. They think they're smarter. They're wrong. They don't realize what they're up against. If you're really smart, you'll know what you're up against. See, true intelligence is able to give an accurate appraisal of what you're up against. Whereas kind of fake intelligence, you know, guys are very manipulative. Those are manipulative but not really intelligent. They think they can manipulate any situation, and they don't have an accurate appraisal of what's going on. So there may be plenty who say, don't worry, be happy, everything's gonna be fine. You know, those are the manipulators. They think, hey, we can find a way around anything. Not true. Not true. You will not be able to find a way around what is coming. The level of planning is way beyond what most people are aware of. The techniques are way beyond what they're aware of. And the whole situation is way more severe than what anyone really has a good grasp of. And you will not be able to manipulate your way around it. Not at all. They're going to be busting heads. So the key is, don't underestimate it. Wake up from the dream. Don't think you can keep modifying the dream. Hey, we can find a way to around this thing, no problem. Not true. Not true. Not true. Not true. Awake from the dream. That is what you can do. Everyone can do that. Everyone can do it. That is something that everybody can do. There's not anyone here that cannot awaken from the dream. So do that. Don't try to manipulate the dream. Don't try to modify the dream in any way. Don't think that your safety lies in manipulating the dream, because it doesn't. All right. Just awaken from the dream here. Get out of all this darkness. Okay. Be really cool. Real coolness is to awaken from the dream. Don't think you can ride out what's to come in this world by just kicking back and listening to some cool jazz or something, you know. Like, hey, I'm cool. I'm all cool. I got this cool jazz playing. No, it's not going to be like that. It's not going to be like that. Because what you're going to be listening to is what someone else wants you to listen to. What you're doing is what someone else wants you to do. Every facet of your life is what central planning wants you to do. And when central planning sees you're no longer helpful to it, goodbye. Organ harvest time for you, okay. Goodbye. You're no longer helpful or effective for what they want to do. You need to be sacrificed for the cause. That is the truth. So don't think that just because you play along that everything will be fine. It's not true. They'll say, you know what? We would need to move someone else into this position, someone younger. This one, he's become a burden to society. Goodbye. Here you go. Have a nice seat here in this chair. Here's a nice video screen. I think there was some movie, Soylent Green or something. Here's a nice movie screen, music, everything, beautiful people. And here you go, just relax, you know. And before you know it, you're sleeping. That's it, you're gone. And just some kind of, you know, injection or something. Then your organs are harvested, etc., whatever. That's it. That is what the world will come to. So There's no mercy. There's no mercy in existence. Existence doesn't have mercy. It is hell-bent on developing this power that has a greater power than the powers that the Prime Creator created. And it will sacrifice everything. It's constantly sacrificing, non-stop sacrifice, grinding everything into dust. It will do that to you as well. But you can awaken from the dream, and then, dream has no power. You realize it never had any power over you. Never had any power over you whatsoever. Never had a power over your identity. Never had power over your experiencing. Never had any power. You've just been dreaming all this. So, align your life right now with awakening from the dream. And don't stop. Keep going. However you want to go about it is okay. But don't kid yourself. You need to actually awaken from the dream. Okay? You need to be in that, somehow be getting that feel from whatever you're paying attention to, of awakening from the dream, the entirety of the dream, not parts of it, the entirety of it, and experiencing the I am isness, presence, and knowing that is your true identity and nothing ever happened to it. That you have to be going that way, however which way you do it, you know, and not hooking up with some clever manipulator thinks, hey, don't worry, we can just kind of redefine everything and manipulate everything. No, that won't get the job done. Awaken from the dream. That is your goal. That is your purpose here. That is where your efforts must be. Look at the very root of it and stick with it. I'm involved in this whole situation with you. So I'm just putting out this urgency, realizing that we have a short amount of time. So don't be a slacker. If you want to wake, don't be a slacker. If you're doing your investigating, do your investigating. Go for it, you know. Really get it done. If you want to investigate all these different satsangs and spiritual retreats, all that kind of stuff, get it done. So you can say, I've been there, done that. That's not what I really want. What I really want is to awaken from the dream. I don't need to leave a spiritual retreat here, there, blah, 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 all this kind of stuff. Forget it. I want to awaken from the dream. That's what I really want to do. So get after it. Get after it. All right, quite a video. I didn't know I was going to say all this stuff. You never know what I'm going to say, and this has come out way stronger than I expected, so hopefully I can sleep at night. Probably, you know, we can still say these things before it's too late, while we still can. While we still can, it's incumbent upon us to say these things and to do everything we can to awaken from the dream, to set the dream down and help others do the same. It's incumbent upon us to do that. All right, that's it for this video.